Hallo, ich sehe, wir sind jetzt live. Also, noch ist keiner online, aber ich freue mich. Los geht es gleich. So, jetzt geht es los. Wir sind live auf dem Channel der Stiftung Kunst und Kultur Bonn mit unserem nächsten Live-Talk. Heute sprechen mit der Künstlerin Katja Nowitzkova. Hier ist sie schon. I'm switching into English. Hi, Katja. Great that we're
Hi.
having you. Let me quickly introduce this format. My name is Johanna Neuschäfer, and together with Anne Schwanz, I'm from Office in Part, and we are co-curators of a wonderful show coming up next year, which is called Diversity United, which travels from Berlin to Moscow and to Paris. And it's the Diversity United is the title of the show. In the exhibition, there will be more than 80 European artists, and one of them is Katja Nowitzkova from Estonia. And after last week and the week before, we started a small interview series with the artists who are participating because, of course, we want to introduce them. We want to speak with them a little bit about the works that they are doing and showing in the exhibition. And so I'm really happy to speak now to Katja. Hi, Katja.
Hi. Hey.
I hope everything is good with the connection and everything.
I think so. Yeah, I can hear you really well.
Perfect. Perfect. So I'm starting very easy. It will be a little conversational interview. And first of all, so I hope you're well. Where are you? And the other question, where are you from? I would start with these two very easy questions.
Yeah, so I am originally from, I'm in Amsterdam. In Amsterdam, Netherlands. I'm currently here. I'm originally from Estonia, from Tallinn. That's where I grew up. I lived there until I was 22, and then after that, I left to study to Germany and then later Netherlands.
So, as we can clearly hear, you are a typical European artist or typical European person. You're born in the 80s and you grew up in Estonia and the Baltics. And so for us and for the audience, we think it's nice to hear about your European idea or what means Europe to you, also in a practical sense, but also in a broader way.
Yeah, so just to, I mean, the Baltics were of course part of Soviet Union. So I remember the collapse of Soviet Union and my childhood was, you know, colored by this collapse. And because of the collapse and because there was Soviet Union, my family did end up in Estonia, although they were sort of ethnically kind of Russian, Ukrainian. But I was born already in Estonia, in Soviet Union. And then by 2001, I think Estonia joined European Union. And after that, I was still in high school. And after that, I joined the Euro. And it became easier to basically think of yourself as, you know, capable of traveling abroad, actually, to Western Europe and to study somewhere, to work somewhere. So from my class, from my generation, especially of the Baltic kind of youths, half of the people at least left to different European countries to study and work. And I kind of just followed that path as well. It just, you know, I did it in, not in IT, not in like some other sectors, but mine was always like, I want to study culture, I want to study design, I want to study art. And then I got some scholarships and I was able to travel. And sort of my life changed because of that. I ended up studying in several European institutions in Germany and Netherlands and kind of gaining access to people from all over the world and learning about different cultures. And somehow that really changed my life in a way that I ended up being able to have a career in contemporary art as an immigrant, basically. And that's like something very special that basically could not have happened without Estonia joining European Union, because I just remember, you know, getting a visa anywhere, Western Europe or Western world, was very difficult before that. And yeah, and then somehow in the broader sense, I think Europe is it's an interesting question in the broader sense, because it's a more complicated question. I think it's, yeah, I think Europe is a kind of a fantasy. But also it's a fantasy that everybody sort of upholds in some capacity. To people that have different ideas, in each country there's a different idea what Europe is and how they relate to that. For me, the reality of it became sort of a more dominant thing. I've been living here since I was 22, which is like 13, 14 years. It's like a big chunk of my adult life has been here. So I was really shaped by living here. And by here, I mean both Germany and Netherlands. I've been living between the two countries for this period of time. And of course, traveling to everywhere else.
Yeah, I think this really explains what I think also I'm the same generation, and I think this is exactly what we know about Europe, is this freedom of communicating and commuting as well. And of course, today we also, with the pandemic at the moment, we have the feeling that we understand how important and how great this is to move from one place to the other so freely. But to jump from this European perspective to your artistic work, I would like to generally ask the question, so what is your field of research about in your artistic practice? Because you are kind of a artistic scientist, if you would say it, or say it like that. So maybe you can introduce your work or your general work a little bit.
Well, I'm definitely not a scientist. I'm too not smart enough for that. But I've always been interested in different scientific fields, and I sort of ended up. I studied graphic design and semiotics, so I never really went to a fine art school. I went to a design school, and I went to like a university. But by the time I was in my mid-20s, I kind of was exposed to a lot of artists, and I ended up becoming an artist. And my method is influenced by my background, which is basically, you could say it as a visual research type of method, where I kind of poetically and creatively scan different information online and around me. And I kind of accumulate this information into artworks that could be installations, sculptures, or publications, and things like this. And it's a method that is kind of, it's very intuitive, but it's also rooted in kind of, as you say, looking into researching whatever is happening today in the world or historically, and trying to build new connections that haven't been there before, hopefully to kind of present a narrative that is interesting or unexpected, or something that, to me, first of all, some kind of connection and associative network of things that makes it art, basically. It makes it into this thing that is always hard to explain what art is, but as almost like an outsider to art, I always have a feeling, okay, now this is art, and now this is somehow I get there by doing things that are not really maybe seen as artistic practice, which is collecting material basically and processing it.
And for the Diversity United, you collected ideas and materials, and you created a new piece for the show. And I would really like to hear more about the work that we will be able to see starting in Berlin in spring. And maybe you can say something about the title, but basically also about the field of topic that you picked, or that was picked by you in these times for this exceptional piece.
Yeah, so for me, the word diversity, of course, is very loaded, and yeah, it's socially loaded, especially also the exhibition. It has this sort of it's like kind of like almost like a catalog of different perspectives from different European artists. And for me, one of the things that I, as kind of a critical thinker, contrarian, I always think, well, if it's about Europe, I have to make it something global, because for me, there's still the border is always a mirage in a way. And that's one thing that I wanted to do. And another thing, there is a border, there's an idea of a border, but actually, you know, it's just the planet Earth. You can cross the sea, like many people are trying, and you can be in Europe, or you can be in Europe in a way that I was born sort of, you know, Russian, but I ended up in the Estonian state. And then the other thing is that my work is about, a lot of it is about nature. And so for me, it was like, yeah, the diversity I want to focus on is biodiversity, not just social diversity, but this idea of biodiversity, because biodiversity is sort of crucial to, it's one of the kind of the pillars of the earth that is collapsing at the moment, and together with a lot of other things. And this year, because we sort of started to really think about the artwork as kind of the same, around the same time when the COVID virus came into being. And I kind of saw this as an opportunity to create an artwork that combines all these topics in one, in a very smooth way. And I found basically this narrative about the apocalypse of the amphibian, of the amphibians. And amphibians are basically frogs and salamanders, these kind of creatures. And this is like an ecological disaster that has been happening for several decades, that has sort of an origin in one country, which is South Korea, and then it spread globally, and it also spread to Europe. And basically a lot of species of frogs and different salamanders and amphibian species are kind of going extinct at a fast rate. And a lot of it is due to this fungi, this viral fungi that causes the diseases in frogs, like skin diseases. They cannot breathe with their skin, so they die. And the interesting thing about this story was that this idea of like one single origin that then becomes global through mutation and through globalized trade and through through like events like wars, like Korean War, and then it becomes sort of inescapable. And basically the same thing happened to the coronavirus. And when the coronavirus appeared, we, you know, of course, at the beginning, we thought, oh, it will not reach Europe. And then it just like reached Europe in an instant. And oh, it only affects certain kinds of people. And it's like, no, it affects all kinds of people. It doesn't matter if you're, you know, and then it ended up affecting heads of state of European countries. And then it became like, okay, it's actually inescapable, in the same way that kind of a culture that a ecological crisis is inescapable, on the example of this amphibian apocalypse. And so the work is called Apocalypse's Many Horsemen, approximation, the apocalypse's many horsemen. And basically and it's actually a quote from one of the articles I read about the amphibian crisis. And I used it in as part of the title, because it's basically, you know, it's this biblical imagery that is very, again, very culturally familiar to all of us, but it's applied to something that is like barely noticeable in our daily life, but actually it's one of the pillars of the world. And for me, it's just a window into kind of the understanding how a small chain of events can lead to a collapse or some sort of massive crisis, and that this corona kind of year might become more of a rule than an exception. And also the fact that no matter how we sort of, people are trying to have a good life in Europe, it's not isolated from the rest of the world. And in a way, the better our life is, the more, for example, in this case, the worse is life for the, you know, nature, let's say, because even with all the policies that have been happening in the European Union to protect the environment, the trend is kind of very clear that the biodiversity is going down, and there's less and less wild spaces, and all and so on and so on. And and of course, one of the reasons why, for example, corona was sort of possible is because of the inappropriate interaction between wildlife and humans. So there's like this kind of intrusion into natural spaces causes these extra crazy kind of effects, you know, that were not anticipated at all, these sort of black swan events. And so for me, this like, how can I put it all into an artwork, because I want to. And so the sculpture that I ended up making has kind of bit by bit mapped this storyline, in a way that I think ended up being very condensed. But again, nobody will know the whole story looking at the sculpture. I'm just kind of telling it to my thought process.
To us lucky ones who can listen and hear so much more and so much more about the whole, yeah, I think this is what your work may is also so special, or why your work is so special also for us as the curators, because you have a very visual appealing, it is visually very appealing, and it can also transport some messages by the images and by the installation. But if you want to dig deeper, you can see so much more into the work and to the critique and to the shout out to an audience. And maybe this is also the last question that I always like to ask as being on the side to speak and think about the artist as the curator or as part of the curatorial team, who and which works will be a part of the show of Diversity United. But I also like the idea to think, what do you wish for the audience to be triggered by when they see your works? And I think with you and giving so much input about the idea behind it, yeah, there is also some sense that just triggers by just having a look at the work.
Well, for me, like I see, you know, the story that I saw told you about, the sort of the narrative behind the work is how I get to make it. But also for me, it's very important, this immediate encounter that people have with the work, where they don't know who I am. They don't know, maybe they don't know a lot about art anyway. And they just see the sculpture and how it affects them visually, their senses and their thoughts, and that, or how children see it. And I kind of always think about that. But also then the visual messages, the visual forms, the kind of the languages that I put in there are kind of, it's possible to make up a narrative out of them if you are able to read them more. So it's just about basically where different people have different kind of ability to interpret the work depending on their background, if they are from sciences or from arts or from some sort of life experience that allows them to interpret it in a specific way. And I think this is kind of the blessing in the sense of a visual for figurative art, that is, it doesn't have a clear text, a clear story. The only clear text that is attached to the work is just this title, The Apocalypse is Many Horsemen. And I think that already sends a lot of people on a very clear trajectory of thought. But also, if you cannot read that line, it's okay. You see something in the sculpture that will affect you, you know, based on just the rules of vision and also the rules of how kind of, there's no rules, but just sort of how human consciousness works, hopefully, and how they relate to it and culturally as well. And also in the context of this exhibition, I hope in relation to other pieces, it will be maybe more clear what I'm trying to do. Yeah. Based on just what it is, and yeah. that's kind of how I always end up thinking of it, like in multi-layered way. Layer one is just this first encounter, and layer 10 is like how does a person who knows me for many years and knows my work and knows everything about my references also see it? And so both are very important to me.
Thank you, Katja. I think this was a really, really great insight into the work, into your work in general. And for everybody who's listening, the Stiftung Kunst und Kultur in Bonn, they posted your work, an image of your work on their Instagram account. So everybody who's now so triggered to being able to see a first sneak of the work, just have a look at the post. And I think we are ending now this little interview. And thank you very much, Katja, that you had the time and that that you told us so much about the work and where you're from and how Europe is, of course, a part of you. And we will do another Instagram live talk next week on December 16. At 6 again with Dan Pajovci, and Romanian artist who will also participate in Diversity United, that will start next year in spring from Berlin, moving then to Moscow and then Paris. And Katja, anything else? I think we are done.
I just want to thank you for commissioning the work, and I was I think it's been interesting for me to think about kind of my perspective on the whole show.
Yes.
And yeah, and I'm looking forward to seeing what other artists have been
coming up for it. Bring everything together, and Yes, thank you very much. And thank you everybody for watching and listening, and see you next week and see you latest in the show.
Ciao.
Okay, thanks. Bye.